Well, I'm very, very happy to be here. Thanks to Tony and to Dean Yakovich and to everybody at the Shepherd School who's made this wonderful conference happen. And I must say I'm impressed with the audience. The interest in music cognition and music in the brain is very encouraging. Maybe we're getting hot. You never know. So let's continue. I've thought about linguistic and musical syntax in one way or another in many different ways, and tonight I'm going to give an overview about all of this, skimming over some things more than other things. Being a musician, I will talk more about music than language, but we'll talk about text setting in particular and its relationship to prosodic structure. And I won't talk about the brain. I leave that to Ani Patel and last night to Professor Zatori. So just a very quick overview of historical approaches to musical syntax. This is just some of the main names, but you can go back to the 16th century to Zarlino, where the basic rules of counterpoint that are still taught in freshman music classes in one form or another were formulated. Rameau in the 18th century started formulating rules of harmonic progression that had a syntactic flavor. And he tried to base them on the acoustics of the day, which meant the overtone series, which had been discovered not long before. One of his contemporaries, Matheson, was just one of the many theorists who applied principles of classical rhetoric to musical forms. In the 19th century, a contemporary of Beethoven, Gottfried Weber, one of my heroes, was really a sort of a music psychologist before his time. And he's the one who popularized Roman numeral analysis, and he started developing pitch space constructs that actually are what we're finding now experimentally. And he was concerned with online processing and ambiguity and all of things that are very eminently psychological. In the late 19th century, Hugo Riemann developed a theory of harmonic function, which I'll refer to later briefly. And in the early 20th century, there's Schenker, whose theory really is a kind of proto-Chomskyan theory before Chomsky, but about music instead of language. That is to say, he posits a fundamental structure which, by a series of rewriting rules, generates tonal pieces. And it's, it's semi-formal, but it's very much in the spirit of a generative theory before the fact. In current approaches to musical and syntax, one can classify them in various kinds of ways. I'm not going to go through this. David Huron covered expectation models, and he's one of the experts in that. There are linguistic models or linguistic approaches. And I have to mention here my book that Tony just mentioned, A Generative Theory of Tonal Music, co-written with Ray Jackendoff, the linguist. And I have to emphasize that it was the methodology of generative linguistics that influenced us. Chomsky formulated ways of thinking about how can you make a theory about a cognitive capacity, and what kinds of idealizations are useful. It was those kinds of things that really influenced. It wasn't the things about language itself, unlike Leonard Bernstein, who tried to translate Chomskyan grammar directly into music. So we were making a music theory, not a linguistic theory, but it was the methodology that mattered from linguistics. And then just recently I've discovered some other people have started making music theories that have a kind of syntactic flavor that look quite interesting to me. I'll talk about one of them a little bit later. And then I would mention another approach to musical syntax comes through spatial models. Spatial models actually go back to the 18th century historically, but in modern times it really goes back to some experimental work and multidimensional scaling, primarily done by Carol Krumhansel and various people she collaborated with in the late 70s and throughout the 1980s. People have very regular, even depending on, it doesn't much matter how much education or even to that much on which culture you're coming from, a very regular sense of distances of pitches, chords, and keys from one another. And this is quite robust evidence and so on. So this excited a lot of people in music theory, including me. So when I started building my model of tonal pitch space as a kind of explanatory framework for those results and to try to unify those results formally, and to provide a way of dealing with them quantitatively that would be useful for experiments. So a lot of my later theoretical work came out of this experimental work. And I'll be talking about some of those things later. Finally, I'll mention Dmitry Timoshko, who's just come out with a book that's making a lot of waves in music theory, and it's all about geometries. I'm not so sure it has much to do with the music cognition, but that's another subject, but I thought I'd mention it. And finally, there are biological approaches, going back to Darwin and to some contemporaries, where people who think that that language and music originated in expressive vocal utterances. Then there are various people have done comparative evidence with animal cognition, and Ani will talk about comparative research in neuroscience between language and music. He's the expert on that. So with that brief introduction, linguistics is usually made into this tripart division of phonology, syntax, and semantics. Syntax is really the interface between sound and meaning. You can think of it that way. And then the question, I suppose, is how does music fit into this tripart division? And it doesn't necessarily have to fit at all, but it does fit in some ways. So I have these thoughts about it to start things off. First of all, music lacks semantics in a linguistic sense. There's no lexicon, not any normal reference or truth conditions, et cetera, et cetera. Music is basically non-propositional. Now, around the edges, there can be reference. There can be quasi-propositional things, as in Wagnerian leitmotifs and so on. But in general, I think this statement is true. So music is very meaningful, but it's not referential. Music has a syntax in the sense that it is hierarchically organized. Now, that's a very general sense of syntax, but it's the one I'm going to go with today, because it also includes phonology. Phonology, since the 1970s and throughout the 1980s and since then, has developed a hierarchical way of treating sound structure. That is complementary to linguistic syntax. So one can talk about phonological syntax fairly decently. And both music and phonology project organized sound and time hierarchically. So perhaps it stands to reason that music would be closest to phonology. And certainly when it comes to text setting, that's the main thing. Before I get to that, let's consider syntax from an abstract point of view. So I'm going to define syntax as the hierarchical organization of discrete sequential objects. You have to have objects. If sounds are just continuous, then there's no the possibilities of combinatorial complexity are very small. You have to have separate objects so that they can combine in a potentially infinite number of ways. So that's true not just about language and about music, but all kinds of things. Once you have a string of objects, there are various ways of organizing them. I would argue that there are basically three ways. There could be a nested grouping of objects, a prominence grid or a metrical grid, one or the other, assigned to two objects, and there can be a headed hierarchy of objects. So I'll treat these each in turn. This is just an abstract representation of five objects. And objects one and two are grouped together, and objects three, four, and five are grouped together, and all of them are grouped together at a larger level, so it's a hierarchical system. But within any grouping, there is no hierarchy. That is to say, object one doesn't dominate object two, or vice versa. Rather, they're just grouped together. And same with three and four and five. So that's a simple kind of grouping, and I'm not saying how they're grouped or why they're grouped that way. Often it involves Gestalt principles like proximity and similarity and parallelism, things like that. And here's an example of a metrical grid. Not all grids are metrical. In this case, the bottom level, which is I've designated as the eighth note level, is essentially isochronous. It's periodic, that is, and beats that are strong, felt to be strong at that level, then become beats at the next larger level. So it's in that sense that it's a hierarchy. So at the next level, we have the quarter note level, which are every two beats apart from the eighth note level. And then at the dotted half note level, now it's every three beats, we have a strong beat. So we have a one, two, three, one, two, three metrical grid. So this is a representation of a 3-4 meter. There are various kinds of meters. Meter is basically superimposed periodicities that are in phase. There could be some exceptions to that, but that's basically the case. Actually interesting exceptions, but I won't go into that now. So headed hierarchies now. The difference between headed hierarchies and the other two is that there's real domination of one event over another. This goes back to X-bar syntax, which is something that Chomsky developed in the 1970s, and my collaborator Ray Jackendoff contributed a lot to this also. The basic idea in language is that if in a syntactic category there's a dominating part of speech, so in a prepositional phrase it'll be the preposition, in a verb phrase it'll be the verb, in a noun phrase it'll be the noun. So I've done a very simplified version here on the in conditions A and B. So we have X and Y, either before or after, and X dominates both cases. This can also be represented purely by a tree structure where one dominates the other. And this tree kind of tree structure notation in C and D is what we use in the generative theory of tonal music. So I've been illustrating some of these things now using the Beatles song yesterday. We'll start with the text, with the first verse, and the first word is yesterday. So let's do that one. There are three different ways of representing this. They're all pretty much equivalent. They've been all of them used in the literature. The first one is an SW tree, S for strong and weak for weak. So you can see yesterday grouped together and then day, and yes is stronger than ter, so it goes up and dominates that, and then I should have marked it, but it then marks the entire as a word, because yes is stronger than day in terms of prominence. This can also be shown in B with the stress grid. This is now, this doesn't have to be isochronous, but each syllable gets an X. If a syllable is stronger, the next goes to the next level, it gets two X's, and then yes gets three because it's stronger than day. And underneath it is the syllabic grouping, which is called the prosodic hierarchy, and there's a whole set of principles about the prosodic hierarchy. Actually, it would be the prosodic hierarchy for more than a word, but it's the same basic set of principles. And then finally, this can be represented by a simple tree structure, as in C. Now, to do the analysis of the first line, yesterday all my troubles seemed so far away. Text setting is basically finding a good match between a stress grid and a metrical grid. A stress grid is all assigned by the phonology. So we get yesterday and all my troubles seem so far away. Far away because there's something, a principle called nuclear stress that emphasizes the last strong syllable in a word at the end of a phrase. That's a principle that applies in English and German and various other languages, but not all languages. So if you find a metrical, you have a repertory of metrical grids, and the issue is to find the best match. So in this case, the match is very close. The one exception is where that parenthesis is, where a beat has to be added, because you can't have two strong beats next to each other in a well-formed metrical grid. So that parenthesized X there corresponds to the comma. So we say yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. It's as if there's a kind of silent beat there. Underneath is the prosodic grouping, which involves criticization and phonological intonational phrases. And it's a whole thing that I borrowed from linguistics. This is can also be represented by a prominence tree. So it's an equivalent notation, essentially. We can also make this in musical notation because the lowest level of the metrical grid is in steady beats. So if we assign that to an eighth note, then we have yesterday. So yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. Finally, if I go back, there are three syllables that have three X's at the metrical grid. Also, they did in the stress grid. They're the most stressed syllables. So if we put those a little bit higher, because a major contributor to stress is pitch height, quite remarkably so. So therefore, I'm going to perform this as yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away, which is a fairly natural way of saying it. So now we'll look and see what the Beatles did. This is Paul McCartney.
Yesterday, all my troubles seemed so far away. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday.
I'll let us stop there. Oops. How is this different? It's pretty much the same, but he does a couple of things. He doesn't say yesterday all my troubles. He goes yesterday all my troubles. So he has much more of a pause at the comma. And then all my troubles seem so far away. He emphasizes far instead of away. I did all my troubles seem so far away. But he says all my troubles seem so far away. And why does he do that? It's because he's using something called focus in phonology, which you can change the meaning a little bit of an utterance by how the stress goes. So he's emphasizing far because his troubles seem so far away. It's much more, they're really far away. He's emphasizing that because now he's going to tell you that he has troubles now. So he longs for yesterday. And also tonally, the music is going from F major to D minor. So. So he's going to a different key, which is relatively far away in this language, to express the far awayness. So all those things are happening. Also, yesterday, even though yes is on a very short note, it's on a dissonance. And so because it's on a dissonance, it's marked. It's sort of, you sort of feel it more strongly because it's dissonant there. So he is able to put the stress partly through a musical method of using dissonance, something that isn't available to language by itself. There are more that I could say about this, but I'll move on to the syntactic tree for this line. There are different ways of doing the syntax for this tree. I asked my friend Jackendoff to do this one, which is a little different than what I had done myself, but basically the same. So what this tree says is that there's a noun phrase, yesterday, which acts adverbially to the rest of the utterance, so that it branches to the top there. And then there comes a noun phrase in which the head of the phrase is troubles, and there's a verb phrase in which seemed is the head of the verb phrase, and then there's a prepositional phrase for which away is the preposition or the head, and then underneath that is a quantifier, so far, a quantifier phrase, and then a degree on that. So that's the analysis of it. So it looks a little different than the musical tree, which is now what I'll talk about. So look at that tree, and then look at the next tree. This is a prolongational tree, what we call a prolongational. Just think of it as a hierarchical tree that represents tension. If there's a left branch, going into a longer branch, that means that it's relaxing into it. If there's a right branch, it means that there's tension coming off of it. So we have yesterday relaxing into day, and then with the change of harmony, next beat, next downbeat, there's an increase in tension. Then all my troubles seem so is all around on a dominant chord, expanded, which then cadences into so far away, and then far as dissonant, and then resolves on A in a way. So that's basically what's happening there. And underneath it is an equivalent notation using slurs, just as in syntactic theory. If you know any syntactic, studied any syntax, you can represent syntax not only by trees, but also by brackets. And so this is kind of a bracket notation, but it's using musical slurs. So I'll play it once more, just this phrase to let you sense that there is what this phrase is basically doing, there's a momentary tension, then relaxing to the tonic at day, and then there's a real departure. And tension leading up on troubles so far away, then there's a momentary tension on far, which resolves it away.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away.
Okay, stop with that. Now, if you look at the two trees, there are various differences. The parsing is a little bit different. But what's really important, what the real difference is that the syntactic tree has parts of speech and phrase categories, whereas the musical tree doesn't have anything like that. What the musical tree has is just departures and returns, tensions and relaxations. Everything is elaborational. So this is a fundamental difference between music and language, which is, and this is perhaps the principal reason why I would say that music is closer to phonology rather than to linguistic syntax. Musical trees represent elaborative relationships without grammatical categories. So I'm going to take another example now from Schubert, the song Morgengruß, Morning Greeting. It's a song from his song cycle, Die Schöne Müllerin, the Pretty Miller Maid. And I'll give you the text here, pardon my German. Guten Morgen, Schöne Müllerin. Good morning, Pretty Miller Maid. Wo steckst du gleich das Köpfchen hin? Why do you thus draw back your head? Als wäre dir was geschehen, as if something had happened. Verdrießt dich denn mein Gruß so schwer? Does my greeting annoy you so much? Verstört dich denn mein Blick so sehr? Does my look disturb you so much? So muss ich wieder gehen. So then I must go. So that's basically what's happening. And what's this is a song cycle that tells a story. It's kind of like a mini opera. And essentially, there's a happy young miller who's wandering by a brook, and he sees this pretty miller maid in the house, and he falls immediately in love with her. And she has her head out the window. So he's what he's doing in the song is, at first he rehearses to himself, oh, I'm going to say greeting, and then she's going to say, oh, how are you? And then they're going to meet, and they're going to fall in love, and then everything's going to be wonderful. But what actually happens is that he says, good morning, pretty miller maid, when he actually says it, and then all of a sudden she draws back her head and closes the window. And then he says, oh, as if something had happened. Then he's all alone and saying, did my greeting annoy you? Did my look disturb you? Well, then I must go. So then he decides to go, but he doesn't go. In fact, the music sort of sits, and it cycles around itself, and it sits on a tonic pedal, and so he doesn't go, which is a disaster for him, as you might expect. So that's, with that, I'll play the song. This is with Peter Pears singing and Benjamin Britten at the piano.
Wo steckst du gleich das Köpfchen hin, als wenn dir was geschehen? Verdrießt dich denn mein Gruß so schwer? Wer stört dich denn mein Blick so sehr? So muss ich wieder gehen.
So, in a prosodic analysis, I'll just do a couple of lines. Guten Morgen, Schöne Müllerin. The stress grid and the metrical grid align quite well. As you can see, I've turned the metrical grid upside down. I guess I should have said that before. I've indicated the beats because if you're not used to it, the metrical grid might be a little hard to read. So there's so beats 3-1-2, 3-1-2. That's how it phrases. The real difference, though, is that he doesn't observe the comma. Schubert doesn't he doesn't have the singer say Guten Morgen, Schöne Müllerin. Instead, he says Guten Morgen, Schöne Müllerin. So it's almost like he's a little bit nervous already. So he says Guten Morgen, Schöne Müllerin, as if he wants to get it out quickly, in case she'll close the window. And notice also that he says Guten Morgen. He rises. That's one way you can say this in German. Wouldn't have to do it with a rise, but it's indicative of the fact that the actual contour in musical melodies doesn't necessarily have to correspond to the sort of standard melody of speech. And in fact, the melody of speech could be quite variable. The intonational theory is very complex. Now I'll take one more phrase. I'll take the last one, so muss ich wieder gehen. Here there's an interesting mismatch, which is, normally it said so muss ich wieder gehen, but he says so muss ich wieder gehen. So he's emphasizing that he must go, and he knows that he must go, but in fact he doesn't go. And eventually that leads to his disaster later on. But the basic setting is basically well aligned between the two. So to go any farther with the song, I now have to digress into something more purely musical, which I'll talk a little bit about tonal tension, which comes out of my book Tonal Pitch Space. And it's something that doesn't have a linguistic counterpart. The things I've talked about so far are essentially rhythmic and involving grouping and meter and time span segments and so on. But the pitch part of music really doesn't have much in common with, or has almost nothing in common with language except for contour. So I have to digress a little bit into the music theory. Generative theory of tonal music basically has this form. It takes the idea is to take as a musical surface, which we take from musical notation. It should be ideally the audio signal, but life is short. You can't do everything at once. So we take the notated music, and when somebody hears a piece of music that they understand implicitly, it doesn't mean that you've studied music. You have this internal knowledge of all this structure that's going on. You know where the phrase boundaries are. You know where the strong and weak beats are. You know what's an ornamental pitch, what's a structural pitch, what's a dissonant chord, what's a resolving chord, and so forth. So you have all this internal knowledge. And so what the theory tries to do is make a set of rules that takes a musical surface and predicts the heard structure. And so to do that, we develop various components, each having a set of rules. And so I've talked a little bit about grouping and meter informally tonight, and a little bit about time span segmentation, which corresponds to the prosodic grouping of the words that I did and phrases, and a little bit about time span reduction with those trees. Stability conditions is something that I haven't talked about. That's basically a set of principles that tells you what's dissonant, what's consonant, whether a chord is close or distant from the tonic. And then I haven't really talked about prolongational reduction, except to say that it represents patterns of tension and relaxation. And I was using a prolongational tree when I was doing the Yesterday by the Beatles. So when I developed tonal pitch space, I replaced the stability conditions with three components, all of which are totally quantified. The pitch space model, which basically quantifies the Krum-Hansel results, a tonic finding algorithm, and sensory dissonance. And then on top of that, I made a whole bunch of other components, which I won't go into very much, but just to show you that it's a complicated theory with many components now. And the blue components are shared with language, the red ones, the blue ones are shared with language, the red ones are not shared with language. So that gives you an overall picture. The one prolongational reduction should probably be purple because it's a combination of blue and red. It's sort of on the border between them, but it's the rhythmic stuff up at the top toward the left is the rhythmic part, and that's what's shared with language. So now I've turned some of the red ones into green because these are the main inputs into the overall tension curve. So those are some of the things I'll be talking about now. So now we're back to the Schubert, which I've renotated so that every quarter note corresponds to a measure. That's so that I could put all of this on one slide and make it a little bit intelligible. So I've simplified the music a little bit. But for present purposes, it's the same music. So then we have a prolongational tree above. It's labeled by levels, by these letters. And all those numbers in the tree represent distances of one event to another vent to which it's attached in the tree. And then underneath are some of the basic groupings and the Roman numeral analysis. And then in the middle are three rows of numbers. The first one is dissonance. That's the sensory dissonance component. So it spits out a bunch of numbers that says those are the dissonance relations. The next one is the hierarchical tension. I can calculate tension sequentially or hierarchically. I can go from one event to the next. So I could go. So one of the things that I was interested in finding out was whether this is what people are doing, or whether they're really doing it hierarchically. If they're doing it hierarchically, then they're calculating down the tree structure. So Carol Kremhendel and I did an extensive study several years ago, published in Music Perception, that tested the attention model. And one of our major results was that the sequential modeling is wildly wrong. It's not what people are doing, even if you've had no musical education. People are going down the tree. So this is important because in itself it is, but it also, it's been hard to prove that music is heard hierarchically. Even though musicians know that music is hierarchical, it's kind of an experimental design problem. How do you show that? So we've shown it through tension, that you can't get the right results unless you go down the tree. So then the third row is the attraction component. I haven't talked about attractions yet. Attractions are kind of a spin-off from the fish space model, from the tension model. It's an idea that's been around for centuries. The basic idea is that certain pitches are really attracted to other pitches, and certain chords are really attracted to others. So if I'm in C major, then if I'm on the leading tone, let's say. Even though it's just a half step, so it's the same distance, but the attraction essentially goes one way and not the other. So this is building on work of other people, Steve Larson, John Trevorucha, and so on. I generalized attractions so that to create a kind of attractional force field in which all pitches and chords are attracted to all other pitches and chords, like a gravitational field in a metaphorical sense. But most attractions don't really count because they're so minuscule. What really counts are really strong ones. So, and I have an algorithm that spits out these numbers, and that's what those numbers are at the bottom. So, we have all these numbers expressing aspects of tension. I also want to say that the attraction component also expresses a kind of expectation, because if a pitch or chord is highly attracted to another pitch or chord, the second pitch or chord is strongly expected. And if it's not highly attracted, then it's not strongly expected. This aspect of expectation arises from the dynamics of the tonal system itself, from the schema of learned schema that we have, also tied to these psycholinguistics. And it's essentially complementary to the schematic and vertical expectations that David Hieron talked about last night. I can illustrate a little bit with something from Die Meistersinger. Die Meistersinger is a later opera of Wagner, and as is well known, Wagner attempts more often than not to have deceptive cadences in his later music. So instead of going,
or some other deceptive resolution,
the one that he particularly likes is in Die Meistersinger is the one that I just played. So in this case. So if you're used to late Wagner, then schematically you expect the deceptive resolution. And if you know a particular passage, it's going to happen that way. But what the attraction model says is that even though you know it's going to happen, still the attractions say that it really wants to go to the tonic. So that is process is calculating away regardless of any other schematic stuff that you may have in your head or any knowledge of a particular passage of music that you might have. So going back to our example here, I'm now going to hone in on one moment, which is particularly interesting.
Which is this. what to do with it as listening. It's very unusual. So, but then when the next word happens, then suddenly we know where we are. Because whether you're studying music theory or not, you suddenly know that you're in D minor. That is to say, you know that you're in a key that we call D minor. You know that you're in some different key. Because those two chords go in the in key of D minor. And then we get the rest of the history expression. Happening is that we get a kind of sequence going on. Is this so we get this parallel structure going on. So what happens in both cases, the G minor chord that's so strikingly odd, and the F minor chord, these are exactly the places where he's disturbed, where he feels that there's something wrong. And that's what this is expressing. And but in both cases, you're puzzled, and then it's clarified afterwards. So retrospectively, you can make sense of it. So I should have showed the music when I was doing that, but I played it, so that's okay. I'll get back to exactly how my model deals with that in a second. But first of all, you can make a graph of normalized values of these rows of numbers. That's what this is right here, and then we can make a composite graph from that, which expresses the total result. And in the initial analysis here, it's at event 12, if you can see, where I have two sets of numbers. There's a 7 and a 24 in parentheses, and a double branch to that event. That's the G minor chord, and there's two ways of calculating it, one of which is much more tense than the other. But the first one says that I've calculated to a G minor chord is just a minor dominant, but there's nowhere to go with that. But then when the A major chord happens, then you reinterpret it and you realize, oh, I've gone to D minor, and that was a four chord in D minor, so I'm calling it that. You, as a naive listener, you wouldn't know that, but you do sense it. And so what's happening is that you're realizing suddenly, oh, that you've gone further away than you realized at first. So that this shows up in the graph. In the first case, I've taken the smaller number at event 12, and then the tension, the real tension, is later before it relaxes again. But in the second time, which is more retrospective, the event is most tense right at that spot, and then it relaxes more gradually. So this is what I'm claiming is happening in real time as listeners going through the music. There's a certain amount of tension at first on event 12 on the G minor chord, and then when you realize what it really is, then there's really a lot of tension there. So it changes your hearing as you're progressing through it. This particular case hasn't been tested yet, and I'm eager to find out if my predictions are true, or what if I'll have to modify a part of what my predictions are insofar as I possibly can within the theory. But I'm somewhat optimistic because things worked out well in my experiments with Crumb Hensel, so I have a feeling for how these things work now. Now I'm going to, at this point in my talk, I'm going to move to some smaller subjects and point out another alternative musical syntax which I discovered only a month ago when I was in Germany. There's this person called Martin Rohrmeier, who took Riemann's functional theory and built a computer program that gives you this tree structure. It looks very different than my trees. It's very complicated. It has basically parts of speech are transferred into music. Each of these are functions. So if we get a prolongation there we get a tensing and a relaxing. A tonic region. Any of these things, a tonic region decomposes, it's kind of like an X-bar phrase, and then it will decompose into a tonic at some point, and so on. Then that you can spell the tonic out into a one chord and out into a G major chord, which is the tonic of this chorale of Bach.
I'm not going to play you the Bach chorale. There isn't time to do all that. But it's just to show you that there's another way of doing this than I've done. So I'm quite interested in it. I'm particularly impressed that he's able to do it, get this parsing, at least in this case. I don't know how generalizable this is, but in this case, he gets a pretty decent parsing that doesn't depend on a rhythmic analysis. I'd put this whole thing through my own system, which has the same kinds of numbers and so on, but a much simpler tree structure than his. But it has underneath all the rhythmic structure that his doesn't have, and it has all these pitch space distances in the tree. So there's more hidden behind my tree than his, but his tree is more complicated. So if I were to compare them, because these are really interesting issues for anybody who's making a theory about music and its relationship to syntax, I would say that my approach posits a kind of minimalist elaborative hierarchy without grammatical categories. And it relies on rhythmic parsing and on pitch space as inputs to the tree structure. I didn't show that, I should have showed it. It assigns functions, but the functions are read off the tree. So the functions are not part of the grammar. It's really just a readout from the tree. It does have functions, but then all the adjustments elsewhere happen elsewhere in the model. So if you were to go to a different kind of music, it might have a different scale, different kinds of harmonies, or maybe not even harmony at all. It might have different kinds of metrical structure. So all those other components then would feed in, but the basic nature of the tree structure wouldn't change. Whereas in the Rohrmeier, he posits grammatical categories, which he takes from Riemann, the 19th century theorist, and these describe function. But these are real grammatical categories, and one immediately wonders, how on earth could this ever be transferred to any other kind of music? So that's one of the main reasons why I didn't ever take this route. Jackanoff and I talked about taking this route at the beginning of our theorizing, and we decided not to because we wanted to make a kind of theory that could be extended to all other kinds of music in some way or another. But his method is closer to standard linguistic syntaxes than ours. I should mention, though, that certain recent developments in the minimalist syntax program take away a lot of the stuff that used to be in trees. So maybe there's some kind of convergence happening between current linguistic theory and our kinds of tree structures. I don't know. Now, a few words about sequential ordering in music. And this is a really important difference between music and language. Various languages have case markers, like Latin or Czech or Turkish, so you can scramble the words and you still know what the syntax is. But in English, especially in English, but in many other languages, ordering really matters. So I could say the boy kissed the girl, I could say the girl kissed the boy, and the difference is the ordering and as to what is the subject and what is the object. And also, there's no equivalent in music to syntactic movement, which has always been so important to the generative tradition. So for example, if I said the girl kissed the boy, or the boy was kissed by the girl, I turn an active into a passive, and you move a bunch of stuff around. As far as I know, there's nothing like that in music. And I'll mention one other aspect about sequential ordering. There's actually many, many topics one can address in this. But phrases, generally speaking, I don't know how cross-cultural this is. I suspect it is somewhat so, but not completely. But in any case, in Western music, phrases tend to begin in a state of relaxation, usually on the tonic or something like that. And then there's tension in the middle, and then relaxation as the cadence comes, as there's some kind of closure. So that's your typical phrase. It doesn't have to happen that way, but it's normal. This shows up in my theoretical work in a component called normative structure. And so the tree underneath describes that pattern. But what's interesting from the point of view of sequential ordering is that if you have something like this, if you have a tonic, and if you have a cadence, cadences are the most formulaic aspect of a musical style. And so the number of cadences in classical music in particular are quite limited. But that's true of other musical styles too. If you ever want to understand a musical idiom, you should first look at the cadences and see how they work. So if you have the tonic and you have a cadence, which is usually a couple of things that happen, then in order to have a departure that produces tension, and in order to get something that can prepare the cadence, the possibilities are enormously pared down. It constrains hugely the probabilities of what can happen.
So that leads then to a certain sort of typical things that do happen. So you tend to get very probable kinds of chord sequences or melodic sequences that happen because of these constraints, I would argue. So in other words, the need for attention and then going to movement into tension and then into relaxation has all kinds of consequences about probabilities of what's going to happen where. And that's an interesting subject which I think is worth exploring in the future. I want to talk a little bit now about structure at global levels, which is another interesting thing between music and language. Linguistic syntactic trees are really all about the sentence. And larger linguistic levels express discourse or information structure, but the theory of discourse and information structure is much less developed than within the sentence. But in music theory, it hasn't been that way. And this goes back to Schenker. Schenker proposed basically a 1-5 tonic-dominant-tonic progression with certain linear progression within a phrase. And he was able to generalize this, find this pattern at larger and larger levels, all the way up to the level of a piece. So you can take the Mozart G minor symphony or something like that, and it's one hierarchy. So this influenced a lot of people, including me. And so in generative theory of tonal music, we had trees that were rather global. And this has been criticized, I think justly, by various people. There have been various experiments that show that listeners don't hear long-range tonal connections terribly well unless they have perfect pitch. Of course, performers will notice the difference, but just talking about listeners. So in tonal pitch space, this is something I touch on briefly, but it's something I'd like to explore further. I think that what's critical is not whether an event returns. So in other words, if a piece is in C major, that it comes back and cadences in C major at the end, after 10 minutes. But rather, what's really important is that you have the sense that you've ended on a tonic. In other words, what matters is the return of the function. So if you begin on a tonic and you depart, and let's say you go to some other key and you cadence, you start in C major and you cadence in B major. If you've established B major as a new tonic, that's fine for most listeners. So I have a kind of mechanism that shows how this works. Another interesting issue about analysis at larger levels is about what are the units of analysis. In these tree structures that I've talked about for music, the leaf of the tree, that which to the branch goes, is an event, what it means is a pitch or a chord. Now, but is that what's really happening in the course of the G minor symphony? I start to get a little bit uncomfortable whether we're hearing all those events, and certainly we can't retain all those events throughout. So, in tonal pitch space, one of the things I worked on came off of the work of Robert Geerdingen, who developed these schemas for the Gallant style, which is a 18th century, mid and somewhat late 18th century style, which is highly formulaic. And so you get all these little formulas of melody and harmony that are very standard, and composers are sort of shuffling them around all the time when they compose in that style. So he worked these things out, but he didn't really analyze how they work technically. So I did that in tonal pitch space, and where I showed what the prolongational structure is, what the metrical structure is in each case, and so on. And this was particularly interesting because certain schemas of these little mini schemas, certain of them are at the beginning of a phrase, some are at the middle of a phrase, and some happen at the end of a phrase or a section. So you start to get something that's like a syntax. These things are, it's not just anything, but they happen in a certain order. And one that begins a phrase you'd never find at the end, and so on. So so I did this analysis about how these things work, and I think the next step then is to sort of take what I might call a molecular level of analysis, where each of those schemas, which I've atomized into all its parts, is a kind of complex molecule. And so then the next level of analysis would be the leaf of the large level at prolongational tree would be not the individual event, but rather that molecule, that complex of those little schemas. And so if that's done, it also solves another problem about
hierarchies, which is that if you have a very complex hierarchy, you have enormous depth of embedding, which becomes very hard to process. But if you have fewer, there are going to be fewer molecules than there are atoms underneath. So to continue the analogy, so if you have molecular units of analysis, then you're going to have fewer events to relate in the hierarchy and much less depth of hierarchical embedding. So this is something I would like to pursue in the future. And I want to talk now just for a few seconds about recursion. This is because there's a famous article by Hauser, Chomsky, and Fitch from 2002 in which they make a useful distinction between the broad language capacity and the narrow language capacity. The broad language capacity is those parts of the language capacity that are shared with other capacities, whether music or some other capacity that humans have. And the narrow capacity is something that belongs only to language. So they make this rather remarkable claim or hypothesis that only one thing about language is in the narrow faculty, and that's recursion. And what do they mean by recursion? They mean not just a hierarchy, but they mean specifically the ability of language to self-embed the same structures, particularly a sentence. So if you have a sentence embedded within a sentence, and you can do that indefinitely. So you know the man went to the store, which is on the corner, which is painted red, and I could keep going on with all kinds of embedded sentences. So that was the claim that language uniquely has this feature. This upset my friend Jackendoff and Steven Pinker, and they wrote a rejoinder to the Hauser, Chomsky, and Fitch article, and there was a big brouhaha between all of them. And so this has been discussed a great deal. So I guess I just have to point out that in music, it's kind of to anybody who's worked in this area, it's quite obvious that we have recursion in music. We have that little normative tree that I just showed. Few slides back, where you start off with a tonic, and then you have tension, and then you have a cadence. I mean, that happens within a phrase. It happens, you know, within a section. It happens in a whole piece. That's just one example of the kinds of recursion that happen in music. Now, it doesn't mean that all music has recursion. There certainly are musical styles that don't, but it's something that's available. It's part of the musical capacity. So, a few words about contour. Obviously, music and language share a contour, but in speech, it's by continuous glides. But in music, pitch height is usually steady from one pitch to the next. As a result, musical systems have fixed intervals, and speech does not. This is true also of tone languages. So I could go on and show how this works in the Schubert case. I just did the second part of the first phrase is a kind of elaboration of the first part. Of the basic thing that happened before. So I've just shown that now on the second level here. Those numbers for the contour are just showing that it goes up a sixth and down a second, down a second, down a fourth, so on. So it's a very simple way of representing contour. And one can also go on further. I'll skip this now, but one can treat this melody in terms of streams, so that it has a kind of hierarchy in that sense as well. And one can treat the streams at various levels of reduction. So music definitely, musical contour definitely can be treated as a kind of hierarchical syntax. So the question then is that the case of linguistic contour as well? So the answer really depends on whether there are discrete relative levels of pitch height in language. And you need that because syntax requires a string of objects. So you can't just say go up and down. You have to have sort of spots that's sort of in the up and down that are the nucleus of the up and down, which are discrete points in the analysis. This is a disputed subject in intonational theory, but it's an ongoing dispute. It's not anything that's been settled. But if there are discrete levels, then linguistic contour can be organized hierarchically. And this is something that I've pursued in some other work of mine on the sounds of poetry viewed as music. So I'm going to make a quick bridge to this just so that it can lead to a conclusion in general about music and language. I'm not going to, this would be a whole different lecture. But the sounds of poetry, if you just take the sounds, not dealing with meaning or symbols or anything like that, but if you just take a poem and take the sounds, so I've done that and run it through the components of a generative theory of tonal music. And it's, you get all kinds of interesting results, some of which are implicit in the stuff I've shown you earlier today. Poetry typically adds meter and timbral patterning to ordinary spoken language. Most spoken language is not metrical. By timbral patterning, I mean rhyme, alliteration, assonance, and so on. Of course, free verse doesn't necessarily have that either, but most poetry does. So those are added structural elements to normal language. And then you can make all these correspondences between music and prosodic structures, which I won't go into now, but just to say that they exist, and it's something that I've worked on. When I was working on it, I heard the neuropsychologist Isabel Peretz give a talk, and I was very pleased because she came to some conclusions about brain deficits, in behavior caused by lesions in the brain. Which corresponded to what I was concluding from my study of music and language. Basically, she concluded that rhythmic structures are shared by music and language, but that they don't share. In the musical case, pitch structures are separate from anything in language, and in linguistic structures, the syntax, that is, linguistic syntax, is separate, and everything having to do with the lexicon and semantics and so on, and certain parts of phonology are not. So that's what this diagram basically shows. The common structures, and this is my conclusion from my work on music and poetry, and which is basically the common structures are grouping, stress, meter, contour, and timbral patterns. In music, musical structures only are pitches, intervals, and scales, harmony, counterpoint, tonality, pitch hierarchies, tonal tension and attraction, all some of the things I ran through tonight. Linguistic structures only include syntactic categories and relations, word meanings, semantic structures, other parts of phonology, such as distinctive features, which I haven't discussed. So that's the general picture that I would draw about music and language and syntax and what fits where. And one can also take an evolutionary perspective on the same thing, because the common structures belong not only to humans, but also to expressive vocalization in non-human animals. So we're coming back to Darwin now, who was the first to talk about this. So if you have a dog, or if you go out in the backyard and listen to the birds, you'll notice that they group sounds, that certain sounds are more stressed than others. In the case of songbirds anyway, there's often a kind of metrical structure. There's a periodicity at multiple levels in the signal. There certainly is contour, and there are various timbral patterns, certainly not in all cases maybe, but in whale song and certainly in bird song. Learned songs, birds that make complex songs. So these do exist in species widely distant in the evolutionary tree from humans, and they exist in our ancestors as well. So these are all common structures that precede music and language, which are uniquely human activities belonging to all musical cultures. So it makes sense to sort of posit this as a core out of which both of them came. So this is my final hypothesis, that the common structures evolved first, and that music and language subsequently developed from this root as specialized yet overlapping human capacities. Thank you.
Yes. That's a great question. It's, when I'm talking about tension, I should have made this clearer. I'm talking about something called tonal tension. I used the word, but I didn't explain it. There are many kinds of tension, and certainly there's the tension of great expectancy. There's a tension coming from a certain sort of patterns that you've learned. There's a tension, above all, if you go faster and louder, you're going to get more tense. And that's something that has nothing to do with music or language, even. So now the question is about that G minor chord, and it's, when you first hear it, it's ambiguous because you don't know what to do with it. You don't know where it belongs. And that's, how does that get treated in the theory? I sort of know how it works, but I don't have a quantitative model of that yet. So what I have is how one hears it prospectively, and how one hears it retrospectively, and how it can be calculated down the tree. But I agree that there's a kind of tension that's simply caused by uncertainty. It's a technical issue. It's something I haven't solved yet, but it's a great question to ask, and something that they should be solved. Yes?
I have a question about the poetry, but you were saying, like, is there a software to develop that you, like, I could put, for instance, like, a poem in French or any other language and have a structure of the poem only based on the sound?
That would be a wonderful thing to achieve, right? This is something that should be done by the phonologists, I think. Bruce Hayes, who's been my main, is a very good phonologist at UCLA. He's quite musical, and he coached me in phonological theory. And he's very good at making computer programs, so you should get him to do that. Because it's something I would like to have as well. I don't have that. Yeah. I mean, it's certain parts of my own music theory I have implemented, not all parts of it. But that's something that one would love to have. And of course, if you go into another language with a very different accentual structure like French, since you mentioned French, that would lead to a whole different set of issues that could be, they're quite complex and not fully resolved in prosodic theory. Yes? That's great. That's perfect. Actually, I have a component in my treatment of poetry that makes prolongational structures, what I call prolongational structures, that shows the return of rhymes and the returns of alliterations. And the thing is, it's other theorists have talked about these things and pointed them out, but they haven't treated them hierarchically. But in my system, it's entirely hierarchical, so I can show how the alliteration is embedded within the rhyme and so on. And so if you have a repeating unit, such as a refrain in a ballad or a hymn, something like that, then yes, it's very much part of the structure, and it's very, very musical. And I think it's something that people sense is very musical. And so the elements in question are poetry rather than pitches and chords, but the kinds of structures, I think, are exactly the same. So yes, absolutely. Yes? Well,
I have a question about tonality too. While you're talking about tonality being only in music structures, I was thinking of other languages like Chinese.
And Chinese, I don't speak Chinese, but I'm just telling you what I've been told by phonologists and various people. Tones are relative. I mean, a woman and a man can both express the same tone. Differentiation in meaning, because the way you do a sound is sort of part of the lexicon for a word. And so a man and a woman can with different voices, different pitch heights, or you know, somebody of the same gender who has a lower or higher voice, you know, or you know, if you're speaking along, generally speaking, if you speak, like, this came up with David Huron last night, I think, generally the speech tends to decline as an utterance goes on because you're running out of breath. All these things happen. So there aren't fixed pitches in tone languages, but they're relative to the context, to their immediate context, and it's enough. There's enough information there for you to be able to distinguish between one quote tone and another. But it's not. Maybe the word tone could be a little bit misleading if you're talking about tonality or tones in music, where we really have fixed pitches. So this is something that really belongs to music and not to normal speech. There are certain kinds of speech which approximate something really quite in between. Rap is a little bit like that. Hip hop. To me, hip hop is interesting for that, and perhaps only that reason. My kids try to get me to like hip hop, and I failed. Once I heard Joseph Brodsky read his poems in Russian, and it was like he was a cantor, singing. It was really singing. It was quite extraordinary. I felt that I could just sit there and write it all down in musical notation. Yet it was speaking. It wasn't quite music. So there is this kind of gray area. We have something called Sprechstimmen and certain kinds of music in Carol and Eric Schoenberg and various composers have used it throughout the 20th century. So that's another case. So there is this kind of gray area in between, which is very interesting, which is a great interest to composers and to me, as a composer, but certainly as a theorist. But the question of tone languages doesn't come into this. I also learned an interesting fact recently, kind of minor fact, I guess, but it turns out that the next question would be, well, when they sing, do they observe the tones, the contour of the tones when they sing in Chinese opera? So the answer apparently is that in Mandarin they don't. They don't really care. But in Cantonese dialect of Chinese, they do care. So there they really observe the contour. When they make a melody, they really observe the contour of the tone. Okay. One more question. Yes?
Have you tried your theory with some other classical music, Indian classical music, for example, which is very, very wide, comprehensive set of system, and I don't know how it would apply to your theory?
I think it would apply quite well. I love Indian music. Jamshed Bharucha, was mentioned last night also, was a prominent music psychologist, grew up in India, came to America, has done some cross-cultural studies of tone hierarchies, meaning what pitches are perceived as more stable than others in Indian music, using Westerners listening to Indian music, Indians listening to Western music, and so on. And the correlations are pretty good. I think I know how I would make a theory of Indian music, but I would have to collaborate with an Indian ethnomusicologist or a native Indian musician of some kind, and I haven't done that. But one of the frustrating things when you make theories about music is that ethnomusicologists are, as a rule, not all ethnomusicologists, but ethnomusicologists as a rule tend to be cultural anthropologists, where they're interested in making thick descriptions of a particular culture, but they're not so much interested in the music itself as they are in how music behaves in society. So it's a kind of anthropological endeavor for most ethnomusicologists today. But if you study phonology, phonologists mine all the languages of the world. They're just eager to go out and find another language where they can test some hypothesis to see how general it is, or find some new exception or some new principle or something like that. And that's what we need to do in making music theories about the musical capacity is to do in-depth studies of different kinds of music, both from other cultures and historically as well. So I've expanded the theory a fair amount historically, but I haven't gone to other cultures with it yet because I would have to make these kinds of collaborations. But it's something that I wish would happen. So thank you very much.